children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
Praise Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Oh,
he is worthy to be praised.
Amen. Hallelujah. Put your hands towards them as we pray the Aaronic prayer, Sabbath prayer.
All the people.
Time and people are asking me questions. What is going on? Are we in the last days? I mean, I'm not going to show you that, you know, biblically, but not really truly. We're, I think there's a lot of birth pains going on. You know, it's getting ready for that time. It's getting ready for that time. With all the stuff that's going on, people say, where are all this? I mean, unfortunately, that, you know, George Floyd had to get killed in that manner. And that kind of triggered off everything. But the looting and the protesting and all that stuff, is, protesting is one thing, but looting and killing cops, and, I mean, all this stuff that's going on. You got to understand there's a demonic influence out there. I mean, you know, the devil's alive and well.
Yeah.
And he's still in the last, within the last days, he understands that like we do, and he's on a leash. He knows his time is short, so he's going to do whatever he can to destroy the things of God and destroy people and people's lives. And then you have people like, you know, Antifa, and you got people like George Soros who's funneling and paying protesters to do that. The people actually get paid to protest. And I'm pretty sure he's paying them good money because there's a lot of protesters. So, you know, it's evil in the world. Mm-hmm. And we have to understand that we have to stay focused on where our help really comes from, and that's God. Okay. So, today we're going to talk about a lot of things today. We're going to talk about some of those issues that are happening. We're going to also lift up that message about the battlefield of the mind, because people are still battling. We're going to keep people in prayer. Mm-hmm. I know Amber is going through some real trials and tribulation. You know, I had a chance to, you know, talk with her a little bit this week and go back and forth in a conversation with her. And he's just going through. Brad is really, really, really ill. Brad, as a matter of fact, you know, we got to pray for him. And he's not doing too well either. He hasn't been able to work for like over a year, and all that stuff has taken a toll. So we got to pray for Amber. And, you know, she's, I thought she was going to be here today. I hope she still makes it, but I don't know. She's still battling some things with her family and just one thing after the other. Yeah. Then Chuck is in the hospital. Chuck is not doing too well. He's in the VA hospital. He's getting some tests done on him. And we got to pray for Chuck. And just keep on praying for our people. And we're gonna, you know, how many of you know that we you know, we have our focus could be broken by the enemy, but we have to really, really be focused on who God is. Everybody say amen to that.
Amen.
All right, so we're gonna worship our God. Let's pray before we start. I just want to pray a general prayer for us. Heavenly Father, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, I just lift up, first of all, our congregation. I lift up our people. Father, I lift up our country. Yes. I lift up Israel for the peace of Jerusalem, Lord, like you command us to do. Father, what happens in Israel happens to us too. There's even controversy and turmoil going on there, and has been going on for centuries and centuries. So, Father, we pray right now, Lord. We need your help. We need your guidance. We need your comfort. We need total spiritual understanding of what's going on. And Father, we ask you for revelation and knowledge upon your people. We pray, Father, for a divine order to take place, not only in the body of Messiah, but also in this country. Father, there's divisions everywhere we turn. But Father, the devil is the master of division and strife. But you are the God of order and divine justice and divine peace. So we're going to trust in you no matter what. Your word said that we're in the last day, that there will be trials and tribulations, rumors of wars, people against people, children against fathers and mothers against their children. There's nothing but uneasiness in the world. But Father, you came to give us joy. You came to destroy the enemy. And Father, I know you're going to come back and finally do that. But Father, in the meantime, your word says, those who are faithful to the end shall be saved. So, Father, let us be faithful to the end. Let us not be weary in well-doing. And, Father, give us a strength and a supernatural ability to do what you have called us to do. And that is to worship you, love you, and honor you and be faithful to you until your return. So, Father, we give you praise. We surrender the service unto you. Let everything that happens here today be all of you and none of me. And I pray for those who are sick in body. Father, we pray for Chuck. And Father, we pray that you touch him right now divinely. Let a divine healing power come upon him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. We pray for Amber, Father. We pray for her family, Lord. We pray for whatever is going on there, that you also will bring divine order. And Father, today we're going to ask the question, why? Why, God? Why do these things happen? So hopefully, Father, by the revelation you have given me, Father, we're going to share it. And Father, people will have at least a little more understanding of why things happen. So, Father, we give you praise, and we dedicate again the service unto you. And will all God's people say,
amen,
amen, amen, and amen. Let's worship our God, our King. Amen. Come on, we can hang together. Give him praise. Come on, hallelujah. He is the Lord God.
Hallelujah.
Our King.
Worship the King in his city tonight.
Lord. Hallelujah. Praise Him.
Have come and gone, still we wait. The promise of Messiah is within our hearts. Our faith is strong, our souls anticipate. We cry out that your kingdom come.
Yeah. Show me your face. Fill up this space.
I believe it's a song for now.
My world needs you right now. My world needs you right now. I can't escape being afraid. Fill me with you right now. My world needs you.
Every breath that I am made, oh, If you are grateful for everything he's been, everything he said he would do, that his promises are yes and amen today, give him another massive praise in your relentless truck.
Amen. Has he been good to you? Come on, put your hands together. Has he been good to you? Hallelujah. I need a mic. Again. Yeah, we're gonna do that, but let's do the special first, and then let's do the special first. David, what's David Malbert? David, come on, go.
to always to honor God and worship Him. So, David, help yourself.
I had a fire pastor because I was doing things with piano and stuff like that, and I was kind of struggling and so forth. He said, David, will you consider taking lessons? And I said, I thought about it for a while. I don't know how long it took me to make that decision, but I did it. And I now am entering my fifth year. I don't get any degrees or anything, but I do have the satisfaction and the excitement of being able to do songs, perform songs better, vocally and on the piano. And this pianist, you're going to see, but I don't know if we were able to find his name, but if I could play like him, I'm going to go on concert. That'll be 3 or 4 years from now. I'll be 76, and then I'll go on tour. And so
there you go. Thank you.
But I must tell you, folks, I did grow up in the inner city in Detroit, and St. Louis, Missouri, even back then. It was a challenging situation. And I was in Detroit in 67 when some folks decided to tear up downtown Detroit. And I'm telling you, that's as scary as could be. We were in an apartment complex of one block, and we had people on top of the walkie-talkies, and we had the National Guard of the church that I was attending at the end of the street. And that is not the way to protest. So this song here was written during the time of the civil rights. I think shortly after Martin Luther King, I don't remember when Martin Luther King passed away. This was written in 65. And what I'd like for us to do, if we can, is stand on this song. It's only about 3.5 minutes. And it repeats the chorus several times. And then it has a couple of verses, and I'll sing the verse when we get to that. But it's a very, very powerful song. As my brother Highland said, this is a spiritual, and you gotta sing it from your soul. And I hope and pray that I could do that. So, yes, this is a good start. Yeah, if we could stand and sing this together. I think we know it, but you will by the time we get finished, I assure you. He's never failed me yet. He's never failed me yet.
Shabbat, we thank you for resting you. Father, we first and foremost, we lift up, Lord God, Israel to you, Lord God, and we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, oh God. We lift up our nation to you today, Father. When there's chaos, when there's so many things going on, Father, we know that we can trust in you. We know that you're taking care of us, oh God. Though 1,000 shall fall on our side or 10,000 at our right hand, we know that we can trust you. Nothing will come near us, Lord God. So we thank you, Lord, that there's plagues, there's pestilence, there's fighting, there's war, there's rumors of war, there's earthquakes, Lord. There's fires, Lord God. There's weather changes, Lord God. There's floods. But Father, you remain the same. And we're trusting in you, Father. We keep our eyes on you. We pray that you will keep our minds and our hearts focused on you at this time, right now, Father. That we will just seek your face. That we will trust in you, Lord. That we will lean on you, Lord God. That we will continue to trust in your word. Stand on every word that you wrote, Lord God, that you left for us, Lord God. And so we thank you, Lord. We pray for our president, Lord God. You ask us to pray for those who are in leadership, Lord God. So we lift them up to you, Lord God. We pray that everything, every single thing that is going on, Lord God, that you bring it to the light. Every plan, every secret, every attack, those that pay for it, Lord, those that instigate it, Lord, you know, from the highest office to the lowest, Lord, that you bring it out to the light. Because the truth will set us free, oh God. And what the enemy has made for bad, Father, we stand on your word, Romans 8:28. That all things work together for good to those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And Lord, we love you. We are called according to your purpose, Lord. And Father, your word says that everything that is hidden will come to the light.
Yes.
So Father, we thank you that what is hidden is coming to the light. Expose everything that needs to be exposed. Father, we pray that you will protect, Lord God, those in authority, Lord God, policemen, the firemen, Lord God, those that are trying to do good, Lord God, that you will just protect them, that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. All those who rise up against them and against law and order, Lord God, they will fall. It may be party time today, but it's not going to be party time forever. Lord, we pray that in the midst of this war that we are facing with people, with hatred, with bitterness, Lord, I ask that you send legions of angels, Lord, even to those streets, even to these places, Father, that people begin to see miraculous things happen. Things happen, Lord God, that, Father, where people are hating each other, Father, that you will flood them with your love, Lord. Father, that people will begin to just speak the truth in love, Lord God. And love one another, Father. We come against every principality, every evil ruler in this earth. We come against it. We come against those that are inciting war and rumors of war, Lord God. We just ask that you will protect us. Protect your people. Protect our children. Protect our families. Protect our homes, our businesses, Lord God. Our churches, oh God. Father, we just ask that you be with us, Lord God, and bless this nation, Lord God, because this was a nation that was built on the God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, Lord. So, Father, we just pray that you will just Manifest yourself in this service that you will encamp your angels around us today, Lord. We pray for all those who couldn't be here, those who might still be on their way, Lord. And Father, we pray for your word that it will land on fertile ground, Lord. And just we just thank you and we give you all the praise and the glory in Yeshua's mighty name. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Out. We're going to get right into the Word. We got off the cover today. Hallelujah. I want everybody to say this with me. What in the world is God doing?
What in the world is God doing?
Come on, say it one more time. What in the world is God doing?
What in the world is God doing?
Come on now. I mean, you know, people have been getting questions about that. How many of you have ever seen the movie Back to the Future?
Yeah.
How many of you have seen that, Back to the Future, right? Do you remember Doc Brown? You know, the doctor?
Yes.
He told him, you know, I'm wondering if he ever was to tell Marty McFly, remember Marty McFly? He said, whatever you do, Marty, don't set the DeLorean for 2020. I'm wondering if he knew that. What a year it has been, right? 2020 so far. It's not quite over yet. We're 6 months into it. With the pandemic, the lockdown, the ensuing financial crisis, then, of course, the unprehensible murder of a black man by a police officer. That was, again, has ensued protests, and then riots, looting, destruction of property. It is no surprise that the murder Hornet saw that was going on in the United States and decided to go back to where they came from. I believe on a personal level, we may be asking God, why? Why is all this happening to us? Why did I lose a loved one? Why did I get sick? Why did I lose my job? Why do I have to face financial crisis? I'm pretty sure many people have that question probably, right? More than ever now. Why did I lose my business? I mean, there's people that lost their business. And on top of everything else, the riots, some of those cities, they kind of did more damage by destroying the properties in their own neighborhood. Whatever the crisis, I believe we say, why? I believe that one person came to mind when I heard this. I think everybody knows Job. And if you have your Bibles, turn to Job 37. Job 37 describes something that, you know, I'm pretty sure you read this and I read it, and I think now it's kind of like God has given us more revelation on it. Job 37, and when we say why is all this happening, I guess God has the answer. How many of you know God has the answer for everything?
Amen. Amen.
In Job 37, verse 13, it says this. If you dare say amen.
Amen.
It says, he makes things happen either to punish people or to show his unfailing love. In another translation, it says, whether for correction or for this, or for his world, awful loving kindness, he causes things
to happen. You say, wait a minute. You're telling me God caused all this to happen? Well, the context of this verse is also, you know, if you look at it in nature, you know, the north has coming out of the snow, and we see wind and ice and fires, and we see all kinds of calamities going on. But it refers to everything that happens in our lives also. It is saying that, you know, how many of you know that God is sovereign?
Yes. Amen.
You know, what does sovereign mean? That means God can do what he wants, when he wants to do it, how he wants to do it, whenever he feels like doing it. I believe God causes all these difficulties to happen, and then it describes God's purpose. And again, remember, trials and tribulations, the Bible says there's no rose garden. You're going to go through trials and tribulation. Why? Everybody say this, God has to test me.
God has to test
me. He has to test every creation. Every creation has to be tested. People often comment on the random nature of the world by saying, stuff happens. I know the world says it differently, though, but we say stuff happens. But this verse is not random by God's design. God has a purpose. Now, stuff happens because God is allowing these things to happen to correct us. If you read the verse, in verse 13, he says he makes things happen either to punish people or to show his unfailing love. And I really don't like to use the word punish. I mean, that translation there in Hebrew is not really punish, it's the word discipline. Because that comes from the word disciple. If we are his disciples, then we will be disciplined.
Amen.
Everybody say amen? Okay? So, all these events are, I believe, a corrective, and they help us grow. They're growth orientated. It's not to punish us, but to teach us. Mm-hmm. God doesn't do things to us, he does things for us.
Amen. Amen.
So, you know, I read an article, and it said that a fifth grader who was especially mischievous. After some incident at school, his teacher told the boy that she was going to let his dad know what happened, and his dad was going to punish him. And this young boy kept insisting that his dad will never punish him. And the teacher kind of like was saying, what do you mean? Frustrated, the teacher said, but why? He said, because my dad never punishes me, he only disciplines me.
That's good.
That boy had sense.
That's good.
He was mature for his age. Mm-hmm. He was only 10 years old and understood that his father loved him so much that he would never act in a punishing way instead of a loving, disciplined way. Mm-hmm. So stuff happens. Now, stuff happens also because God wants the good of this world. He wants good things to come out of it. I really believe that all of this, good things are going to come out of it.
Amen. Amen.
I believe that we're going to look at race and we're going to look at things, racial things that are going on differently.
Amen. Yes, amen.
I think we're going to be, you know, I think we all have seen there's racism in the world.
Amen.
It was racism in the Bible.
That's right.
Moses was married to a black woman. Hello?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Come on.
Black is beautiful.
Amen.
And let me tell you something. Whether we're black or white, whatever, there's beauty in all of us.
Amen.
Everybody say amen, because God is in it. God created it. You know, I thank God he created kind of like
a variety
of people. Oh, yeah. Imagine if we all look the same. That would be boring.
Yeah.
Right? And I really believe God did that purposely So you can see how we will react with one another, even though they may act or they look a little different than we are. Think about it. And so I believe that there's something good going to come out of this. I really do. I really believe that, and Romans, my wife's favorite verse of mine, Romans 8:28, that all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose.
Amen.
All things work together for good. And we get mad. Sometimes we get mad at God. I was dealing with one person this week, and I said, I'm mad at God. Because this, nothing ever goes right. Nothing ever goes right. I said, but hang in there. There's something good's going to come out of it. Something good's going to come out of it. How many of you believe that?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Natural disasters, which sometimes may seem devastating, can do good for the world. I learned something. Watch it. I learned this principle recently when I read about, the disasters that were going on in the world. How many remember the fires in Australia? All of those forests, animals got killed. It was fires after fires and, houses are burning down and everything else. And I found out that fires are good for the forest.
Yes.
You know that?
Amen.
A forest needs a fire every so often. Now, I know it's a bad thing when you think about it, but forest fires, this is what I read. Forest fires clear out the brush that needs removal. It also shows us that some pine cones would only release their seed under intense heat.
Right. Amen.
Ooh. I like that. See, the thing is, some of you have seeds that need to come out.
Boom.
Amen? And there's going to be some intensity happening to you.
You go and preach that. Now.
Come on now. All right? Man, praise the Lord. Amen? Some of you have some seeds that need to come out. And just like, I've said it many times before, if you really want to know what a true Christian is all about, man, put him in fire. It's like a tea bag. There was a scenario. A Christian's like a tea bag. The way you're going to find out the flavor is by putting him in hot water.
Amen.
Because you can't find it. You could look at the tea, smell the tea bag, but you're not going to taste the tea until you put that tea bag in hot water. Boiling water, as a matter of fact. So, now, also, the fires was indeed to, not only would this cause the seeds and the brush needs to be removed, but first, forest fires clear out the brush that needs removal. It shows us that some pine cones would only release their seed under intense heat. And then the fire was indeed needed to replant trees, while at the same time it destroyed invasive plant species. Okay? So it was almost like nature doing something to revitalize it. Over the long haul, it seemed terrible for the fire, but the forest fire actually renewed the earth. Isn't that something? Forest fires actually renew the earth.
Yes.
God can use the fiery events of 2020 to bring good to the world.
Amen.
Psalm 120, let's go there. Verse 1. It says, in my distress, I cried to the Lord, and he heard me.
Yes.
It is my hope that this will be a good outcome of this difficult time. That people will turn to the Messiah, Yeshua, and trust him to deal with the crisis we're facing. And we will not only bring good to the individual life, but the impact will be to bring about a better world. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Now, another reason why things happen, and this is the last one, the third purpose of things happen, and unfortunately, if you look at that verse in Job, it says it's also for loving kindness. So the reason things happen is because God really loves us. Think about it. The word loving kindness in Hebrew
is the word chesed. C-H-E-S-E-D. Spelled chesed. Chesed. All right, let me write it for you. Chesed. Remember, the C is always silent before H in Hebrew. Chesed. And this word means, chesed in Hebrew, it means God's loyal love. How many of you know God is loyal when it comes to his love? Because God is love.
Yes.
He faithfully loves us and knows what's best for us. We may not like it. Come on, when we spank our children, we don't like spanking our children. I don't like to see my grandson. My little kid says, huh? Dad, you got soft. At your old age.
Very
soft. No, I'm not old, first of all. I'm just more mature.
Very soft.
He says, I got soft. I said, because I learned there was a time in my life when I didn't think twice about spanking my children. But now, I do spank him if I have to, but I try to talk to him and tell him what's wrong. Mm-hmm. Amen? Sometimes he listens, sometimes he don't. Sometimes I talk to him and I still got to give him a little whack. But you know what? But I don't like to really spank my children. I don't have to. But you know what the God said? That if you don't discipline your children, spare the rod, you're going to spoil the child.
Yes, amen.
Amen. So God allows these things to happen because he loves us. He faithfully loves us and knows what's best for us. Even sometimes we may say, well, that's terrible. I can't believe God would allow me to go through this. He's supposed to love me and I'm miserable? Well, here's an example of that. One man got caught up, and I know you're going to know this. One man got caught up in a government corruption. And it was a big scandal. And actually went to prison for it. You remember Chuck Colson? Huh? Watergate? Anybody ever know about Watergate?
Yeah.
Well, Chuck Colson, first of all, he was a Marine, too. So I really had interest in him, because he was a Marine. And he actually got caught up in this Watergate scandal. And he went to prison. He was working for the president. Think about it. And went to prison. He later said that God allowed this event, He also said that God allowed this event, the lowest part of his life, to bring him to faith in the Messiah. He says he finally got to know the Lord in prison. And he started a prison ministry. And Chuck Colson started what is called Prison Fellowship. That has touched thousands of lives for the Lord. So see, all things work together for good.
Amen.
So God allowed this to happen to Chuck to show him his great love and loyal love. Because, you know, Chuck was probably, if nothing were to happen, he probably would have kept on going in that corruption.
Yes.
And God knows what could have happened. But he died a saved man. Amen. So, again, the question is, why does bad stuff happen? Well, does God allow the dangers of difficulties and distresses of life to occur? Well, he says it real plainly in Job 37:13, which we just read. In other words, the question is, why God? But God answers by saying it's all part of his good plan mm-hmm. for us and for the world. Mm-hmm. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right? Now, let's get into the scripture today, because I'm going to show you some scriptures today that also going to go along with what's going on in the world today. But, you know, we study the Torah in this church, and the Torah is very important. We have a Torah portions that we get into, and when I was reading this Torah portion, I've read this 100 times, but today it kind of brought more light to it than ever before. So let's read this today, and let's go to Numbers chapter 8. Numbers chapter 8. And
The short portion is Behaloteka. Behaloteka. It's a long word. B-E-H-A. Okay, and break it up. Bela. Alo. A-L-O. Teka. T-E-C-H-A. Which means in Hebrew, when you rise. Okay? Now the Lord, in Numbers 8, verse 1 and 2. Now the Lord spoke to Moses saying, speak to Aaron and say to him, when you set up the Behaloteka in Hebrew, which means the lamps, okay? The seven lamps. What is a seven lamp? What is a seven lamp? What's up there? The menorah, which represents the seven spirits of God. The seven lamps shall give light in front of the menorah. In other words, the Behaloteka, which means when you step up, when you rise up, because it begins the instruction on the menorah, the lampstand, to be set up in the tabernacle. Anybody say amen?
Amen.
See, a menorah raising the light of purity, raising the spirit of God. I don't have time to get into it because I have a lot to cover, to go into all the specifics about that. But when you look at the seven lamps or the seven spirits of God in the menorah, I'm looking at it from the Hebrew perspective. And I want you to write this down. See, the menorah is a light of obedience.
Amen.
Say that. See, the menorah is a light of obedience. In other words, seven lamps were lit on the menorah. Why are there seven? Not five, not three, not nine, even though nine is a Hanukkah? Why seven? According to ancient Jewish wisdom, seven stands for what? For perfection and completion and examination. All right? So the book of Revelation also speaks about the seven gold lampstands in the vision God gave to John. Think about it. You know, God told John in this book and in this revelation that it wasn't the cross he was looking for. All right? He says, and I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and having turned, I said, I saw the seven gold lampstands in Revelation 1 and 2. And it continued, if you read that chapter, he says, well, when I do come back, I'm looking for the lampstand in my church.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Amen. He doesn't, see, nothing to take away from the cross, but the cross basically is a sign of the electric chair. That's how they crucified people. People suffer through that. Yeah, that's a sign that many Christians say, well, I use that because God suffered for me. But you know what? I don't think God wants you to see him, you know, in that. He wants you to see him as the light of the world.
Amen.
Right? He's still alive and well. Amen? He's the most powerful being in the universe. Everybody say amen to that.
Amen.
All right? So this is part of this message about the Torah portion for this week. Now, how many of you know that God, there's nothing impossible for God? Yes. And I came across this because I've saved this. I've used it so many different times in this message, but I thought to bring it up again. Moses was a very interesting person, and how God does things for the people of Israel. People were in the wilderness. And when they were in the wilderness, man, they basically, that was a big test. Imagine living in Pharaoh's court, and Moses had it pretty good. And the children of Israel, even though they were slaves, if you notice, when they went into the wilderness, what did they tell Moses? I wish I was back in Egypt. At least I had 3 spread meals a day, and you know, and I even though I work like a slave, but I was, you know what, I was used to it. But most of them, the people were in the desert. But what was going on with them? They have to be fed. Think about it. And when you look at the amount of people that left Egypt, it was a lot of Hebrews, but there was a lot of non-Hebrews that went. Okay? Because Pharaoh, remember Pharaoh's daughter, who was Moses' stepmom? She left with a whole tribe of people. So there was more non-Hebrews or non-Jews than Jews that left Egypt. And that's why God had to call them Israel, because there was a mix of people. Yeah. And Israel is God's people. It's not about religion, it's about God's people. Now, according to the quartermaster general of the army, it is calculated that Moses would have needed 1,500 tons of food each day to feed the Israelites. Think about that. 1,500 tons of food to feed Israel, because it was approximately about almost 1 million people that left, you know. To bring that much food each day, 2 freight trains, each a mile long, will be required. Besides that, you must remember that they were out in the desert, so they would have to have firewood to use to cook the food. That would take 4,000 tons of wood and a few more freight trains, each a mile long, for 1 day. And just think, they were there for 40 years. I don't know if they had any, that's why maybe that area is so desolate. All the trees were burned while they were cooking. Oh yes, and they would have to have water. Oh, can't live without water. If they only had enough to drink, cook, and wash a few dishes, it would take 11 million gallons each day. 11 million gallons. And a freight train with tank cars 3 miles long just to drink water. And then another thing, they had to cross the Red Sea one night. Now, if they went on a narrow path, double file, the line will be 800 miles long and will require 35 days and night to get through it. We see the movie, you know, the Exodus, and Moses lifts up his hands and his arms and the sea parted and people ran across it. And, you know, it happened, and we see the movie, it happened in just a few minutes.
Yeah.
But it would have taken 35 days and nights to get through. Besides, all of the people were large, but they had, remember, they had livestock. They had carts. They had to be spaced in the Red Sea 3 miles wide, so they would walk 5,000 abreast to get over in one night. But God did it. But then there's another problem. Each time they camped at the end of the day, a campground 2/3 the size of the state of Rhode Island was required, a total area of 750 miles. Think of it, this space just for one night worth of camping, 750 miles to camp. So you think Moses figured out all this before he left Egypt? So you think when God told, okay, Moses, take my people out of Egypt and go to the wilderness, you think Moses thought about that? How am I going to feed them? How am I going to, you know, whatever? How? God just told him to go, and he had the faith to go.
That's right. Amen.
And here we are worrying about, you know, little things like even, hey, I hate to say that, the riots could be a small thing to God. Moses could not figure it out, but you know what? He trusted God. Now, with all of that said, do you think God has any problem taking care of your needs?
No.
Mm-hmm.
No.
After that, no. So why do we complain? Why do we murmur? Why woe is me? Why woe is me? You know why woe is me? Because our mind is called stinking thinking.
Yeah.
And we're going to get into the message of the battlefield of the mind. Let's get into this. All right? Let's get into it. Now, we've covered for the last few weeks, I think this is the fifth message on the battlefield of the mind.
Six.
Six?
Yes.
All right, let's get into this. I found it very interesting that in this Torah portion, it kind of mentions even something about this. If you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5, let's go there. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Well, the Bible, not only the Bible talks about the mind, but even the world said, boy, the mind is a terrible thing to waste. Why do we waste our thinking on stinking things? That's why he says, let the mind of Christ be in you. Not the mind of worry, not the mind of concerns. The mind of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. What does it say? We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. That sounds kind of simple. Easier said than done. But when you're going through trial, when you're going through tribulation, when you're going through, you know, that woe is me mentality, and everything is going around you that you're not pleased with, you know, it's not easy. Because we deal with emotion. We deal with physical things that sometimes we don't have understandings to. So what does God say? He's saying casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Right? Now, this Torah portion, and like I mentioned, illuminates that the understanding of the realm of spiritual warfare. How many of you know we are in war?
Amen. Yes.
And guess what? Our enemies are not flesh and blood. They are principalities, remember? Powers, rulers of darkness. The battle is within you.
Yes.
Hello? As the purpose of God wars against the intentions of your flesh. The only way to take authority over these principalities, powers, and rules of darkness is with what? But what have we learned as we study the Torah? The 613 commandments of God. God gave us 613 commandments to fight these principles. Remember, the commandments are called principles.
Amen.
Principles of God. To fight a principality, you use a principle of God. Right?
Amen.
Okay? And we got to get into the practice of it. All right? Now, Lucifer, you know, and the fallen angels were created in the unseen realm. Their protocol, believe it or not, whether you know it or not, Lucifer and his fallen angels, their protocol was the Torah, was the Word of God. They know the Word of God. They know the Word of God better than you do.
Yes. Amen.
And they use the Word against you.
Yes.
Hello?
Yep.
It is critical to understand that these influencing spirits, because that's what they are. They are influencing spirits.
Yes.
They, first of all, understand this. They despise you, but they despise God even more. They don't like God.
Amen.
Because Yeshua lives in you, they despise you. Remember, they had a place in heaven. They lost it. They know that if you believe in the in God, Yeshua HaMashiach as Messiah, in God, you're going to go back to that place that they long for.
Yeah.
They long for that place. They can go. They can never go back there again. So they're miserable. And guess what? That's why they want you to be miserable.
Yeah.
And if you walk around miserable, you're not giving God the glory. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
If Lucifer and these ministering angels or servants of the Most High God were there from the beginning, then they understand the assignment of the earth. They understand their assignment. They understand. It's called familiar spirits. Yes. That are familiar with you. They have studied your bloodline. They have studied your forefathers. They know exactly how to wield that influence to disrupt your focus and render you ineffective. They are masters of deception, seeking to compromise your position with the Most High God. You know, I say amen.
Amen.
Now, so, remember, Adam was a king. Adam had authority over the garden. He was king. Matter of fact, he could actually say what Jacob used to say in the honeymoon is, I am king of my castle. And he could actually say, I am king of my castle, and get away with it. He had full authority and total dominion on the earth. But when these influencing spirits attacked Eve and got him to disobey God, they became what? Fallen people, just like the fallen angels. So the principles of the Torah are given to us to fight against. And this Torah portion speaks about that. Now, let me kind of go to where we are today. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12 is talking about the battlefield of the mind. I believe I deal with this more than any other subject matter. People deal with it than I think any other subject matter. It happens to every believer. But we got to get wise. We're in the last days. We cannot let the enemy keep on beating us up. All right? And I want you to, and the title of this message is, As You Think, So Are You. Matthew 12, verse 33. Okay? A tree is identified by its fruit. If a tree is good, its fruit will be good. If a tree is bad, its fruit will be bad. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay? Now, this says that a tree is known by its fruit. Everybody say that with me. A tree is known by its fruit. And that's also true of me. Hello? Write this down. Thoughts bear fruit. Thoughts bear fruit. Be careful what you're planting by your thoughts. And many times what you think, you will say. Now you got a double whammy. So thoughts bear fruit, but your words bear the seed, and the seed take root. You see? Now, so God is saying what? Really? I could really think on bad things, but you know what? I used to, there was a time that I was always thinking negative things because, you know, I had PTSD and all that stuff that we dealt with. But God says, think good thoughts. Turn to somebody and say, think good thoughts.
Think good thoughts.
That sounds easy. Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. That's a big revelation. Think good thoughts. And now, let's finish that sentence. Say, think good thoughts.
Think good thoughts.
And the fruit in your life will be good. Really, if you think good thoughts, the fruit of your life will be good. Think bad thoughts and the fruit of your life will be bad. I mean, that's common sense. Actually, you can look out, or I should say, look at a person's attitude and know what kind of thinking
is in their life. Now, I heard something today that it just really kind of stayed with me. I heard that a guy was asking a pilot who flies a plane, of course, you know, but there's a pilot that also drives ships. But this pilot has flown many flights. And a lot of hours, a professional pilot. And this person asked him, you know, I think the hardest part of flying is landing. You know, getting up there is pretty easy, but getting back down again and landing safely, that's the hardest part. So he asked the question, he said, what has been your best landing? And how do you approach good landing? And when he says good landing, he says, I really depend on attitude. And the guy said, attitude? He says, you mean altitude? He goes, attitude. He says, what do you mean attitude? He says, a good landing depends on my good attitude surrounding the atmosphere around me. Because if my attitude is wrong, even if the atmosphere around me may be good, I may crash the plane. But if my attitude is right, no matter what the atmosphere is, I'm going to land that plane correctly. I have to have the right attitude to land that plane. Guess what? You got to have the right attitude to land your plane. Can I say amen? So, all right. That's a good way of thinking, right? Now, everybody say attitude. Now, but you can actually look at a person and find out what attitude they really are. They have. Right? I mean, I don't know about you. You can read people's body language. I mean, if you see somebody like this, you know they got a bad attitude. Right? Or they're just like stone faced. There's no emotion whatsoever. Bad attitude. So it's how you think. So as a man thinketh, so is he. Now, a sweet, kind person does not, let me say this, a sweet, kind person really doesn't have mean thoughts. It's not that a person who's kind and sweet cannot be mean, right? Because I'm sweet most of the time. To push the wrong button, I'll kill you. Amen? Now, but an evil person does not, let's face it, an evil person really doesn't have good, loving thoughts. Right? They always have a negative thought. Okay, let's go to Proverbs 23. Let's see this. Proverbs. It's wisdom in Proverbs. Proverbs 23. I hope you're getting something out of this. I hope I'm shaking you up a little bit. Alright? I'm going to shake you even more, because here it comes. Remember, those who be shaken will be shaken. Proverbs 23, verse 7. Proverbs 23, verse 7. They are always thinking about how much it costs, eat and drink, they say, but they don't really mean it. Okay? Have you ever gone to somebody and God said, no, eat whatever you want. It's okay. Eat whatever you want, it's on me. And they really don't mean it? And they say, why don't you just order a salad? With no dressing. They really don't mean it. So in other words, it says, as you think is your heart.
is who you are. Now, I want you to go to Galatians chapter 6, because I want to really encourage you today. Galatians chapter 6. And I want you to really hear what God is saying to us. People are ready to give up. I don't know what it is, man. People gonna, they give up easy, man. Especially what's going on right now. They just like, they're such in a turmoil. Oh, the world's coming to an end, or I don't know what's happening, you know. And then they're living nervous, and they're living upset, and they're living with anger, and they're living with all kinds of emotional problems. Worry. Galatians 6, verse 9. It says, So let's not get tired of what?
Welcome.
Of doing what is good. As just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
And it says in verse 10, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone. Especially those in the family of faith. Amen? Do good. I don't know about you, but you know, I got the video this week. I think Ruth sent me a video about a police officer was getting gas, and she was going through, you know, she's a black police officer, a female police officer, and she was getting gas, and she was just going through, you know, all the traumas that are going on right now. She's a black police officer trying to protect, you know, people in the riots and all that stuff, and you know, and she's being accused of, you know, in so many different ways by both sides. And she said, I didn't have enough money for gas. I mean, I had to go to work that day, and my gas tank was almost low, and I really didn't have that much money on me. So she pulls over and tries to get as much gas as she could. And she pulls over, and a white guy comes over to her and says, can I pray for you? And she goes, ask me a little prayer, action, God, sure. You know, and he prayed for her. Even though she was going through all that, you know, but she goes, this is a white guy praying for me, okay? And I'm a police officer. He says, I'm praying for you, because not only are you black, but you're a black police officer. Mm-hmm. You're really going through it. And he knew it. That's how we gotta be, do good to people. Yeah. I don't know about you, sometimes when I'm even in the store and I see somebody kind of struggling, trying to pay for whatever grocery, I can say, look, don't worry about it, put it on my tab, just pay for it, right? I mean, do that. Do good things if you can. All right? You'd be surprised what God will do for you. So do good when you can. In other words, I want you to touch the Bible. Say, also, don't give up.
Don't give up.
Say, don't give up. All right? No matter how bad the condition of your life and your mind, because remember, condition of your life and your mind. Because the condition of your life could be in your mind. Don't give up. Take back the territory the devil has stolen from you.
Yes.
Amen. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Take back an inch at a time. Don't try to take the whole thing, because sometimes we get greedy. You want to take the whole thing, but take an inch at a time.
Yes.
That's why it says glory upon glory, precept upon precept. It's step by step. Yes. You don't get it all at once. Amen. All right? Amen. Take back an inch at a time. Leaning on God's perfect peace and grace, and not on your own ability.
Yes.
So in Galatians 6:9, it says, don't be a quitter.
Yes. Uh-huh. Amen.
And I know people right now who are watching me, you want to quit.
Mm-hmm.
Now you know who you are. You want to quit. You want to give up. Right? I've never seen God bless a quitter yet. The Bible says those who endure to the end, and why did it say endure to the end? Because
He takes to the end. It's not how you start, it's how you finish.
Amen.
God is looking for people who will go all the way with him and through him. Go to Isaiah. Watch this. I love this. Isaiah 11. Isaiah 43, verse 2. You dare say amen.
Amen.
It says, when you go through deep waters, hello, deep waters, when you go through three deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burnt up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I gave Egypt as a ransom for your freedom. I gave Ethiopia and Seba in your place. Others were given in exchange for you. I traded their lives for you because of you are precious to me. You are honored and I love you. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
God loves us. That's why he allows things to happen. Now let's look at another one. Habakkuk. See your Bible now. That's a name. Towards the back of your Bible. Habakkuk chapter 3. Now, if you know Habakkuk was, of course, a prophet. And this took place in Judah. And let's look at what he says through God. Verse 19 of chapter 3 of Habakkuk. Verse 19. He said, the sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me as sure-footed as a deer, able to threat upon the heights. Amen? Have you ever seen deer, especially when they're climbing mountains? Sometimes you see even some of these animals they climb. I mean, their foot are solid. I believe God does that to us. This says that the way we develop hind feet, in other words, a hind is an animal that can climb mountains, for example, swiftly. Mountain goat, you see that? I don't know if you ever see mountain goats. I mean, actually, steep mountains. They climb like it's so easy. We try to do it, we tumble right down. The way God helps that animal climb that mountain is the same way that God helps us in the spiritual progress, is by being strong in him, with him. He strengthens us. He encourages us. In other words, keeping on. Everybody say, keeping on.
Keeping on.
Come on, say it with me. Keep. Come on, say it one more time. Keeping on.
Keeping on.
In other words, you got to keep it on. In rough times. It's easier to keep going when everything is going nice.
It's times, listen to me, it's easy to quit. People, man, they quit so fast. It's easy to quit, but it takes true faith to go through it. You know that? Everybody say, the choice is mine.
The choice is mine.
All right, let's go to Deuteronomy. I'm going to give you a couple more scriptures, and then I'm going to close this message out for today and continue next week. Deuteronomy chapter 30. The reason I'm saying this is because I know people are going through it right now. God, you know, God is you know, is just showing me this in so many different ways what God has said about all this. God is in control.
Amen.
Deuteronomy 30 and verse 19. Remember, we are a product of our choices. How do I say that? I am a product of my choices. Okay?
Amen.
Today it says, in verse 19, I give you the choice between life and death, between blessings and curses. Now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Hello, look at that. So the angels are watching you. And when the angels see that you're moving in the right direction, they're there to help you. Carry it forth. And he says, so today I give you the choice between life and death, between brother and curse. Now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you will choose life so that you and your descendants might live. Verse 20, you can make this choice by loving your God, obeying him, committing yourself firmly to him. This is the key to your life. And if you love and obey the Lord, you will live long in the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Amen.
Or Israel. So, everybody say, I'm not going to quit.
I'm not going to quit.
In other words, let me say something to you. Your mind is like a computer. There are thousands and thousands of thoughts that are presented to us each day. Think about it. Thousands of thoughts. And your mind just calculates those thoughts. So when it says, take every thought captive, that's not easy. It's not easy to say, okay, you know, okay, 898. Okay, let's see what that one is. Amen? But just take that thought at a time. Take that one thought. If that one thought is telling you something negatively, don't react to it.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Go back to the Word and find out what the Word of God says about that. And take a scripture and apply it to it.
Yes.
Okay? So, we have thousands and thousands of thoughts that come into our mind each day. So, the mind has to be renewed. Right?
Yes.
Constantly. How is that? By following the spirit and not the flesh.
Amen.
You can't follow the flesh.
Right.
Because the flesh is gonna tell you, oh man, you know, you wanna kick the cat, you wanna just go out there and kill the dog, do whatever you wanna do, you know, be mean. Woe is me.
Yeah.
Have a pity party by yourself. Because I ain't going.
Amen.
You can see, understand something. Our carnal mind or our worldly flesh, when you say carnal, is basically the worldly flesh.
Yeah.
It has a mind. Remember what we talked about last week. Your flesh has a mind.
Amen.
Minds have, in other words, you got to understand what your minding, what your mind is at, where your flesh is at. Minds have so much practice operating freely that we surely don't have to use much effort to think wrong thoughts. I mean, sometimes we just think wrong thoughts automatically. It just comes to us automatically.
Yeah.
We're not disciplined. We must choose to think that we are going to make it. I am going to make it no matter what. I am going to release any ungodly soul tie that I have in me. Remember, a soul tie is something that's tied to your soul. There's good soul ties, good godly soul ties that you can grab from people, from places. When you come to church, you should be able to get a good godly soul tie.
Amen.
When you go out these doors, get ready, because there's a lot of ungodly soul ties out there.
Yeah.
So the moment you're in that atmosphere, they're all around you.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know who's going to come where and how.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Amen.
Okay? But you have to understand, your sword is your mind, your intellect, your feelings, your emotions. Those things have a mind. And you have to really have strength enough to come against it. By the Spirit. And you have to go and think in the Spirit. Think of the Word. That's why it's good to memorize Scripture. Read Scripture. If you have to put the Bible on tape or CD in your car constantly.
Yes.
Listen to it. Constantly. Do it. Amen?
Amen.
How come you know the words of all these songs?
Yep.
Negative songs out there. Some of those songs don't mean nothing.
That's right.
Why? Because you listen to it all the time.
That's right.
Right? Well, do that with the Word of God.
That's right.
You want to say amen?
Amen.
All right? Everybody say practice.
Practice.
You got to practice. Practice it. We must choose to think that we're going to make it. And we must also decide not to quit.
Amen.
The word quit doesn't come in my language. It doesn't come to my mouth. I don't think about it. In other words, when we are bombarded with doubts and fears, we must take a stand and say, I will never give up.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Say, I will never give up.
Amen.
Come on, say it.
I will never give up.
Say it again.
I will never give up.
One more time.
I will never give up.
Yeah.
I will never give up.
Amen. Say, God is on my side.
God is on my side.
He loves me. And
He's helping me.
By the power of His Spirit.
And His Word.
You and I will have many church choices to make, folks, because it says, choose today who you will serve.
Yes.
Right.
You will have many choices to make throughout our lives.
Yeah.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
In Deuteronomy 30:19, it says, the Lord told His people that He has set before them life and death. You have to understand, we deal with the realm of life and death every day. It's in you.
Yes.
It's in you.
Amen.
Yes. Amen?
Yes.
You have to know how to take that realm of death and subdue it.
Yes.
Don't give in to it.
Yes.
Fight it. Fight the good fight of faith.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Okay. Can I give you one more?
Come on.
Proverbs?
Yes.
Proverbs 18. I love this. Let me give you a word of wisdom. Proverbs 18. Verse 21. You probably read this a million times. I hope you did. Now listen to it. The tongue can bring life or death. Those who love to talk will reap the consequences. Hello.
Amen.
Amen. The tongue is, the Bible also refers to the tongue as like a rudder of a ship. You could actually get that ship to go left or right, backwards or forward, just by the controlling of that rudder.
Amen.
And that's how your tongue is. Right? Now, the way God helps us, in closing, the way God helps us make spiritual progress is by being with us, to strengthen us, encourage us, keeping on, in rough times, especially rough times.
Yes.
Don't keep on, see, you have to be careful what you say. Some people say, well, I can't sleep. No, say, I could sleep. Oh, I can't make it. I will make it.
Well, the Bible says, well, if you say you're poor, he says, I'm rich.
That's right.
He doesn't say I'm poor. Oh, yeah, you're poor. Okay, I'm poor, too. God doesn't say that. He doesn't agree with you. He does not agree with that thought. He says, well, I don't have enough money. I'm poor. God says, I'm rich. Every time you go to God with something and you complain to God, he has an answer. He has an antidote. He has an antidote. I feel sick. Oh, stop saying you feel sick. I'm healed. I'm healed. But don't be foolish. Do what the doctors tell you. Take your medication. All right? Be right. Do the right thing. Eat right. Come on.
Amen.
You know, I have people that, you know, oh, I have high blood pressure. And we take them out for lunch or whatever, for dinner, and they eat a ton of French fries. Hello. Greasy hamburger.
Yes.
Amen. With bacon on it. A bacon burger. Come on. And you want your cholesterol to go low, your blood pressure to go low, I don't think it's gonna happen. Come on. How many people have had come to the prayer line and says, please pray for me. And they, I have a heart condition, or, you know, I have a hard time breathing, but they got a pack of cigarettes in their pocket. That's dumb. Trust me, I've seen that. I actually went to the hospital to visit someone with cancer. The daughter finally, please go to the hospital and pray for my mom. And she was coming to our church, and I went to the hospital to pray for her. And she was smoking. Back then, they were allowed, I don't know how they were all smoking I guess she was smoking in the bathroom, whatever. She was smoking. She had a pack of cigarettes by the stand. I said, you gotta be kidding me. I said, you want me to pray for you? I can't pray for you. I said, you gotta quit smoking.
That's right.
Come on, some people, I don't know, you know, they don't think. All right. Last but not least, I want you to put your hand in your spirit. Right here. See,
I refuse
to receive
condemnation.
Negative thoughts. Stinking thinking. When negativity comes my way,
I will stand
on God's word by the power of His Spirit to overcome all obstacles, all attacks,
all
stinking thoughts, that they will be from this moment on
non and void.
I draw the bloodline around me, around my mind, around my heart, and no weapon formed against me shall prosper in Yeshua's name. Everybody say amen.
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 All right. Now we're going to get into more of this. We're going to talk about the tongue a little bit more next week. Let me tell you something. The tongue is evil. I found that out. The tongue can be evil. Be careful what you're thinking. Be careful what you say. Everybody say amen.
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 All right. Now, I want to say a prayer for all of us one more time, if I could. Because I believe that we need a spiritual warfare. And I want to pray for those that I know are not feeling well right now. We got a piece of Chuck.
Yes.
Chuck is in the hospital. He's not doing well. And Amber, she needs some prayer and encouragement. If you have a number, give her a call, encourage her. Pray for her over the phone. Amen. But I want to just pray. And if you could, put your hand on your mind or your spirit. If you're dealing with thoughts that are not good, put your hand on your mind. And I want you to repeat after me. Lord, I worship you.
Lord, I worship you.
And praise you.
Praise you.
I will listen to your voice.
I'll listen to your voice.
And align myself with your will.
Align myself with your will.
You have declared yourself to be my healer.
You have declared yourself to be my healer.
Adonai Jehovah.
Adonai Jehovah.
Rapha.
Rapha.
You are true to your word.
You are true to your word.
And character.
And character.
And not a human,
not a human
that will lie.
That will lie.
Therefore, I have confidence.
Therefore, I have confidence.
And I am able to believe.
And I am able to believe.
That you are.
That you are.
Who you say you are.
Who you say you are.
You are my healer.
You are my healer.
Sickness
is a product of curse
that fell on us
as human beings
due to the fall and rebellion. But however, Messiah Yeshua has redeemed us who believe in him from the curse of the law, because he came and took that curse for us, including sickness and disease. So we thank you, Lord. Father, you have assured me that Yeshua bore my sins on that tree, taking them on his own body, and being wounded for our iniquity and bruised for our transgressions. We were and right now are healed by those very same stripes in his flesh and in the word of God. Lord, I receive the forgiveness of my iniquities as part of my salvation. Likewise, I also receive the blessings and benefits of healing of disease that is mine through that same atoning blood of Yeshua Messiah. I trust you, Lord, for the manifestation of my healing in my body, in my mind, and in my soul. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved. For you are my prayer. You are my God. I bless you, Lord. My soul blesses you. In fact, everything in me blesses you. I am constantly reminding of myself of your benefits, including how you forgive my sin and heal my diseases. I thank you, Heavenly Father, in Yeshua's holy name. And everybody say, amen. 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 I want to leave you with this. When you go in your daily routine today, I want you to really start thinking to yourself, what has God really done for me that's good? I'm pretty sure you're going to come up with a lot of stuff. What am I grateful for? Because what happens is we get into a pattern that we start thinking and complaining of what we don't have, instead of thanking God for what we do have. And you say, well, I can't think of any. Well, that's selfish, because if you're breathing, that's a beautiful gift.
Amen.
If your heart is beating, that's a beautiful gift.
Amen.
If you have clothes on your back, it's a beautiful gift.
Amen.
If you got children around you, that's a beautiful gift.
Yeah.
Come on. But most of it, you got God that loves you.
Amen.
What a beautiful gift. Amen. So think about what we have instead of thinking about what we don't have. Everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right? Now, I want you to put your hands together and give God praise. Come on. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. All the time. All right, now we're going to take an offering, tithes and offering. Prepare your hearts to give to the Lord. Ushers, won't you come? If you need a debit form, if you pay by debit, or you need a debit form, you can pay by debit. Lift up your hands. Ushers will give you a debit form. Make your checks out to r.e.c.r.e.c. Okay? r.e.c. Make it simple. You don't have to write out the whole name. Okay? And those who are watching us, especially, we pray that you will call in your tithes and offerings. Some of you have been faithful. And I'm really proud of our congregation and our people. Because even through the coronavirus, where we didn't have anybody here except myself and the sound man and maybe Hyland and Ramon and Flavio, sometimes that was it. God was faithful. You were faithful to give, calling your tithes and offering. And we cannot make it without that, you know. So God is really blessing us in that way.
Yes.
But you need to be faithful. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right? So I want to pray for our tithes and offering. And I want to pray for people to really just continue to be faithful to this ministry, okay? God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, I pray for every gift and every giver. I pray for your blessings upon your people. Father, we pray that your needs, the people's needs will be met, that you will supply their needs. You will supply the needs of this ministry, continue to supply the needs, that every need will be met. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give to you what really belongs to you, because tithe and offering is something holy. It belongs to you, oh God. So I'm grateful to be able to give to you what belongs to you. And I do it freely, out of love, and not compulsion. And not by, again, coercing, but I give it because I want to. So Father, I thank you, Lord. So bless again every seed that is planted in this house, and I pray for our people that you will meet their needs, oh God, physically, emotionally, financially, and most of all, spiritually. Give them strength, and we pray for all those again who are sick in body. And we pray for divine healing in Yeshua's name. And all God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So bring your tithes and offerings to the Lord. Ushers, just stand and they'll come up and bring it to you. Praise the Lord. The Bible says, does it to bring the tithes and offering. Hallelujah. Amen. Now let's all stand as we do the Aaronic prayer. Okay? And next week is Father's Day weekend. Next weekend, we're going to honor the fathers next week. Those who are here and those who have gone ahead of us. So to be prepared to honor the fathers next week. We're going to pray for all the fathers. We have a special thing that we're going to do with the men and the fathers of this church. But what a better way to serve, to honor God the Father by being in his house.
Amen.
Next Sabbath, the Father's Day weekend. Amen. Let's do the Aaronic prayer today. Let's lift up our hands to the Lord. As we do this in Yeshua's name. Yavraka Kadonai Mishkaleka. Yaradonai Panavaleka Vishkaleka. Yasadonai Panavaleka Yasamaka Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May the Lord shine his face upon you.
Amen.
May he be gracious unto you.
Amen.
May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.
Amen.
And grant you shalom peace.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Come on, put your hands together, give him praise. God bless you. If you need special prayer or you need anything, please come up and we'll pray for you.